On behalf of the parish family here at St. Benedict, I'd like to welcome you. I'd also like to welcome Father Dave Tickerhoof, who's joining us here as well, as we gather to offer up our prayers for our brother Richard, as well as for you, his family and friends, during this time of sorrow and sadness. Let us begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
In the waters of baptism, Richard died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory. On the day of his baptism, Richard put on Christ. In the day of Christ's coming, may he be clothed with glory. Let us pray. O God, Almighty Father, our faith professes that your Son died and rose again. Mercifully grant that through this mystery, your servant Richard, who has fallen asleep in Christ, may rejoice to rise again through him, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Daniel. In those days, I, Daniel, mourned and heard this word of the Lord. At that time, there shall arise Michael, the great prince, guardian of your people. It shall be a time unsurpassed in distress since nations began until that time. At that time, your people shall escape, everyone who is found written in the book. Many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake. Some shall live forever. Others shall be in everlasting horror and disgrace. But the wise shall shine brightly like the splendor of the firmament. And those who lead the many to justice shall be like the stars forever. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the book of Revelation. I, John, saw a large white throne, and the one who was sitting on it. The earth and the sky fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. I saw the dead, and the great and the lowly, standing before the throne, and scrolls were opened. Then another scroll was opened, the book of life. The dead were judged according to their deeds, but by what was written in the scrolls. The sea gave up its dead. Then death and Hades gave up their dead. All the dead were judged according to their deeds. Then death and Hades were thrown into the pool of fire. This pool of fire is the second death. Anyone whose name was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the pool of fire. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. The former heaven and the former earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia, give thanks to the risen one. Alleluia, alleluia, give praise to his name. With happy crowns, set apart with Christ, now we shall
be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God, have faith also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and take it to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, you know the way." Thomas said to him, "Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
We gather here this morning as family, as friends, as a faith community to do three things. We come here today to pray, we come here today to remember, and we come here today to celebrate. We come here today to pray, and we know when two or three are gathered in the name of the Lord, our Lord Jesus is present here. He tells that in the scriptures. So we know that our Lord, our risen, glorified Savior, is with us here this morning. And he comes here today to, first of all, enter into your sorrow and sadness. Know that our Lord grieves you at the loss of our brother Dick. And we know this again by virtue of the scriptures. There's that beautiful story when Jesus comes to the tomb of Lazarus, his friend. We're told that he wept. He knows what it is to lose someone you love, someone that's close to you, someone that has a great impact upon your life. Perhaps he saw the tears in the eyes of Lazarus' sisters, Martha and Mary, as they were grieving for their brother. And so he enters into the sorrow and sadness. But he comes here today, too, to speak to us a message of life, of hope, and resurrection. Notice the very first things he said to his disciples in our gospel today. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God. Have faith in me. In other words, he was challenging them to trust in him. And if you put your trust in him, things will be okay. And notice he gives a reason why they should trust him. He says that he's gone to prepare a place for them. And after he prepares that place, he's going to come and take them to where he is. Jesus reveals to us God's plan for us. And God's plan for us, his children, is to be with the Heavenly Father, to be with Jesus, to be with the Holy Spirit, to be brought up into that love of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. If you notice, our first two readings today from the book of Daniel and Revelation speak about that end time. The first reading from the book of Daniel speaks about Michael coming, gaining that victory to us. And when that victory is gained, the book of life is open. Notice both of our readings makes reference to the book of life. And those that found their lives pleasing to God will enter into that glory. They will shine like the stars, as Daniel tells us. What a beautiful image. That shining like stars is a reference of sharing in the glory of God. When there'll be new heavens and a new earth, a new creation, and to be brought up in it. That's what we gather here today to pray, that our brother Dick has found his name in that book of life, and that he has been brought up now into the glory of God to shine like those stars. What a beautiful image it is. But also, too, a little later on in the liturgy of the Eucharist, we're given an image of that heavenly kingdom. When we go back again to the scriptures, heaven is often described as a heavenly banquet hall where the angels and the saints are seated at that heavenly banquet table to be in the presence of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. When you look at the liturgy of the Eucharist, we are given a foretaste, a foreshadowing of that, because we as the children of God here on earth gather around this table we call an altar. And on that altar is made visible our Lord and risen Savior, Jesus Christ. And not only is he made present to us under the form of bread and wine, we receive him beautifully into Holy Communion, where he comes into our heart and to our soul. And this was so important for Richard. It helped to shape him. So we come here today in the context of this Mass, as I said, to pray that the Lord in his love and goodness has welcomed our brother Dick home, and that also too he'll bring some measure of peace and comfort for those of you who grieve the death of our brother Richard. But we also come here today to remember an amazing man, to remember a life that has spanned some 100 years. It's often said in the scriptures, if someone has been blessed with years, they have been blessed by God. If that's true, then certainly Richard has been blessed by God. And when we look at those years, they certainly are amazing. When you look at it, he lived it out through various vocations. First as a son, as a husband, a member of your family, a member of our community. He touched us in terms of his friendship. I can only imagine the thoughts that you must have shared these past several days as you interacted with Richard throughout those years, the memories that you've had, the things that you've shared with him. There's so many memories that I have of Richard. And when I look at it, we see that he was certainly formed by his faith. When we come to it as Christians, we come to an understanding, and we learn this very early in our catechism, if you will. One of the questions is, why did God create us? And he created us out of love, to come to know him, love him, serve him, to be with him in heaven. I think those very words helped to shape Dick, because his life, if you look at it, was a life of faith, a life of love, and a life of service. And he lived it out so beautifully. Not only did he allow the faith to shape him, but he also allowed him to be shaped by that faith in such a way that he shared it with the people around him. There was no question that Richard Dick was proud of his faith, proud of his relationship with God, proud to be Catholic. And that was shaped, I believe, by his interaction here at St. Benedict, which was so important to him. And he shared his gifts, his talents, his faith, his love for the Lord with us here in so many wonderful and beautiful ways. First of all, he was a member of our choir for so many years, and you can see there's a chair here in honor of him. It has on it a choir robe and a rose. He liked it. He had a great gift for music, a love for music, and he shared that so beautifully. Someone right before Mass shared the notion that at midnight Mass one year, that he sang, "O Holy Night," and he still remembers that from so long ago. What a beautiful gift to share. We know one of his favorite songs, and we'll hear it here today, is "O Danny Boy." He would sing that constantly. And even in his later years, when his mind began to falter a little bit, wasn't quite as sharp, he was always able to sing that song, it seemed. It was part of who he is. We also know he is part of our Crucio group. He was a member of the auxiliary of the Legion of Mary, co-founder of the St. Benedict's pro-life movement. And in sharing his faith, he was also a frequent contributor to the Reader's Forum, Letters to the Editor. As I said, his faith didn't just shape him. There was this need to share it with others, to proclaim it. And Dick was not afraid to do that. He was a member of our Knights of Columbus. And so we can see how in so many ways he allowed his faith to shape him and to share it. When I look at Dick too, he gave us a good understanding of how we are to carry those crosses in our life. Let's face it, as the years went on, Dick was stripped of many things. His hearing was going, his sight wasn't there anymore, his memory was going. But he never complained to God. Oh, he had a saying, and I often heard it many times, that growing old is not for sissies. He would often say that. But he seemed to embrace those crosses that came his way. When I would go to visit him, and I had the opportunity to do that on many occasions, once a month I would stop by. One of the first things he would always ask about is the church here. How are things going? Are people coming to church? And then his desire was, you know what? I should be getting back up there and going to Mass myself. And I'm just going to envision Dick getting in his car, trying to drive up here for Mass. It wasn't a pretty picture, but I could certainly understand his desire, because that was such his love for the Lord, his love for the church. The other thing that stands out is we're called to love and serve. And I saw that beautifully as he took care of his wife, Dorothy. As she began to deteriorate, they would still come here for Mass. So Dick would pull the car out under the canopy, open the doors, get Dorothy in, bring her up, put her here in the handicapped pew, struggle back to his car, and drive the whole way back to the parking lot to park. We would say to him, "Dick, there's parking out front here. Just take a spot here." "Oh, well, that's for people who need it." "Dick, you need it." But not in his mind. He wasn't taking someone's spot. And then at the end of Mass, it would be the same ritual. But he did that out of a love. When we journey through life, we don't journey alone. There's people there to support us. What I also saw, the love and support that he received from his caregivers through the years, you can see that that wasn't just a job for them. It was a vocation of love. And they did it so beautifully. Every time I was there, I saw that in action. First of all, I would see that the house would always be decorated for whatever season, from top to bottom, how beautifully it was. And it was an act of love. And I know, and the one I got to know best of his caretakers was Sherry. She's been with the family for 17 years. First of all, taking care of Bob, and then Dorothy, and then, of course, Dick himself. And you can see this wasn't just a person coming in to do a job. It was almost a member of the family. You can see that love, that care, and support that was there. And I think that's what sustained Dick for all these years. We're also just commenting. We say cats have 9 lives. I think Dick had at least double that. There's so many times we thought the Lord's calling him home, and all of a sudden, the next week or whatever, there he is back in his chair singing or whatever it was. It was amazing life. And we can do no better than to try to imitate that as best we can. He embraced those simple virtues, faith, hope, love, and service, and he lived it out to the fullest. So share those memories, and to the extent that you do, we can do no better for Dick than to try to imitate those simple virtues, values that helped to shape him. He was certainly an evangelist for the faith, and as I said, he wasn't afraid to share it, to speak to anybody about it. But we also come here today to celebrate. And we come here not just to celebrate Dick's life, as amazing as it is, but more importantly, in his life in Christ Jesus. And that's where his faith resided. He understood God's love for him. And he understood, too, that the great love of God was manifested most beautifully by Jesus Christ on Calvary. When out of a love for you and us, he laid down his life. And in so doing, gave to us the gift of salvation. And we're tied to that gift by baptism. That's why I sprinkled the water of holy water upon Dick's casket to remind us of baptism. And through baptism, we're given a promise of eternal life. That's what we gather here today to celebrate, that promise given to Dick on his baptismal day has come to fruition. That he has been welcomed home, which is our true home, that home that Jesus has gone to prepare for us, that hopefully he's been welcomed into that eternal kingdom to sit down with the angels, the saints, and the Blessed Mother and come to see his risen and glorified Lord in the person of Jesus Christ, not under the forms of bread and wine anymore, but as he truly is. What an awesome homecoming that must be. And I would like to think in my mind's eye that he's right there before Dorothy, before his family and friends, probably singing again, Danny Boy, to all who will listen. What a beautiful image that is. And that's what we celebrate today. We celebrate the life of Dick, but more importantly, the goodness and the love that God has for us. And hopefully Richard has been received into that today. In closing, then, I'd just like to extend, first of all, to Dick's nephew, Jim, who's taken care of him through these years, for his brother, Paul, for all the caregivers that have taken care of him, the rest of the family, friends, nieces, and nephews gathered here today, to extend to you our deepest sympathies and condolences, but to assure you of our continuing prayers, that our Lord will turn your sorrow into joy, just as he turns death into eternal life. May God be with you, and may he always bless you. Please rise. My dear brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we now join our prayers to his. In baptism, Richard received the light of Christ, Scatter the darkness now and lead him over the waters of death. Lord, in your mercy. Our brother Richard was nourished at the table of the Savior. Welcome him into the halls of the heavenly banquet. Lord, in your mercy. Many friends, the members of our families, have gone before us and await the kingdom. Grant them an everlasting home with your Son. Lord, in your mercy. Those who trusted in the Lord now sleep in the Lord. Give refreshment, rest, and peace to all whose faith is known to you alone. Lord, in your mercy. The family and friends of Dick seek comfort and consolation. Heal their pain and dispel the darkness and doubt that come from grief. Lord, in your mercy. We are assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for our brother. Strengthen our hope so that we may live in the expectation of your Son's coming. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer Jesus Christ and the voices of your people, whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ and grant them a place in the kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Pray, my dear brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Richard, we beseech your mercy, that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your
spirit. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. From the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Benedict and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Mark our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant Richard, whom you've called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages and praise you without end. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Amen, amen, amen. At the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other now a sign of Christ's peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Let us pray. As we humbly present, Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body, food for the journey, mercifully grant that strengthened by it, our brother Richard may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for a moment as Sherry would like to say a few words.
I'm going to read the obituary. Ruth, Richard A. Dick, 100, Geistown, croaked on August 20th, 2024. Dick's soul did not go shooting straight up to heaven like everyone else's does, but it made a detour to purgatory, where he will remain until he's purified enough to stand before his all-perfect maker. Born June 13th, 1924, on the feast day of St. Anthony, to whom he had a lifelong devotion because of many favors he received through his intercession. He was born to Leo and Florence Carr Ruth, preceded in death by his great-great-grandparents, parents, wife Dorothy, Cocoruta, brothers Bob, Bill, John, and sisters Mary Dolores Vaught and Barbara Ann Boxler, and her husband James. He's survived by a brother Paul, and numerous nieces and nephews. He had the unique distinction of marrying for the first time on his 65th birthday. Search that in the business book of records to top that one. Dick had a lot of self-respect after he realized his wife, Dorothy, waited 50 years for that perfect man to come along, and she settled for him. He failed miserably in his youthful dreams to fill his uncle, Babe Ruth's, baseball shoes. He was a proud eccentric in his youthful dreams. He was a proud eccentric, lifelong driver for 44 years of the old big used cars until he finally broke down and he bought a new one. He was well known for his German thriftiness, or if you wish, his Teutonic miserlessness. Not for the money he hoarded, but for the things he saved. Actually, Dick was one of the few Catholics who tithed, and in later years, sometimes he double tithed. Benevolent grower of tulips and daffodils, Dick, who was influenced by well-kept graves he saw in the cemeteries of Germany, he worked hard through the years to keep the graves of his beloved dead well adorned with tulips, and in the spring and summer, flowers throughout the rest of the growing season. He hated violence and sex on TV, hence, he watched little or no TV. He was an ace troubleshooter and number one pneumatical engineer for the former GTE telephone company. He was a self-appointed and self-acclaimed defender of the faith, faithful, active member of the Crusill movement since 1976. Auxiliary member of the Legion of Mary. He was a strong opponent of abortion and pornography. Ardent crusader against cigarette smoking. He was quick to point out that he outlived many of his smoking contemporaries. He was a frequent contributor to the Reader's Forum of the Tribune and Democrat and letters to the editor of the Catholic Register. He was co-founder and faithful member of St. Benedict's pro-life prayer group since 1979. Inactive card-carrying member of the Knights of Columbus, like so many of his brothers' knights, feeble evangelizer of Jesus Christ, faithful member of the Saint Benedict Choir. Faithful member of the St. Benedict's Choir from 1959 until 1995, when he got too old to cut the mustard. He rated himself among the top 20 singers in the St. Benedict's Parish, a view shared by almost no one, well known for his heartfelt rendition of Danny Boy, which he plans to sing at his own funeral, in spite of the fact that his voice had deteriorated. Dick was survived by neither a cat nor a dog. However, he was survived by a colony of squirrels and also chipmunks who saw fit to claim his premises as their domain. Dick and Dorothy had no children, and surprisingly enough, no grandchildren. But they had this consolation. None of their children or grandchildren are going to hell. Not everyone can say that with such certainty. Dick was an eccentric, countercultural person. He had no interest in what the culture had to say. His main interest, Jesus Christ and the Catholic Church, in spite of its many shortcomings, and the scripture. He also had a great love for poetry and the Psalms. It would take him over an hour to recite the poems and Psalms he had memorized. As stated by Dick, "To those who viewed my mortal remains, know thee this. I really was not this handsome while alive." It just goes to show you that Bill Harris and his staff know how to make a silk purse out of a sow's ear. This obituary was crafted and written by Dick himself over the last 25 years. He proudly wrote it, and he revised it over the years so that it stated exactly what he wanted it to say. The family will receive friends from 8:30 a.m. until 9:30 a.m. Saturday, August 31st, 2024, at Harris Funeral Home, 500 Cherry Lane, Richland, followed by the funeral mass at 10 a.m. on Saturday, August 31st, 2024, at St. Benedict's Catholic Church. Father David S. Palace, pastor officiating. Entombment, St. Joseph's Cemetery Mausoleum, under the mosaic of St. Joseph, the patron saint of happy death, and under those watchful protection, his remains will lie until doomsday. In lieu of flowers, Dick requests that all smoking friends, few though they may be, stop smoking for one day in his memory.
Trusting in God, we have prayed together for Dick, and now we come to the last farewell. There is sadness in parting. We take comfort in the hope that one day we shall see Dick again and enjoy his friendship. Although this congregation will disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of his kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of Jesus Christ. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Richard, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Richard in this life. They're signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain. to comfort one another with assurances of faith, until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother Richard forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Dick, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. In peace, let us now take our brother Richard to his place of rest.